It's 1953 and Earth has just survived a Martian invasion. So what's the best plan of action? Well, time travel, of course. The champions of Steampunk Rally will utilize newfound Martian technology, gather some of the greatest minds in history, and hold the most spectacular race ever. Players will draft machine parts, power their inventions with a variety of dice, and try to navigate the dangers of a race to cross the finish line further than anyone else. The winner will serve as Earth's ambassador to Mars and hopefully stop the invasion before it ever begins. What could go wrong? Well, a lot, I suppose. And that's why you might need some help learning how to play Steampunk Rally Fusion, the 2-to-8-player game from Roxley Games, who helped sponsor this video. Steampunk Rally Fusion is the successor to the original Steampunk Rally, and it really dials things up to 11 with a number of new abilities, mechanics, and components. But it should be noted that both of these can be combined into what they call the Atomic Edition for the ultimate Steampunk Rally experience. Today, though, we're going to be focusing on how to play Steampunk Rally Fusion. We're going to be setting up a 3-player game, and one of those players is here to tell you how to do just that.
Setting up the game is pretty straightforward, and you're going to start by choosing which track to race on. Choose either Machu Picchu or Mars, and flip all the track tiles to the corresponding side. Next, you get to build a track in any shape you'd like by connecting 6 tiles in the following order. 1 start tile, 3 middle tracks, 1 finish line, and 1 end track tile. Now, if you want a more gradual learning experience, there are some gameplay adjustments in the rulebook, including a smaller track. But today, we're going to be guiding you through a standard game. Once you have the track built, it could look like this, or this, or even this. No matter how it looks, create a general supply of dice and cogs within reach of all the players at the table. Next, sort all the machine parts and boost cards by color into 4 separate stacks. Turn over the top cards of each stack to create discard piles. Then, flip the draft direction token and randomly place it between 2 players. Now it's time for players to choose their inventors. There are 12 to choose from in Fusion, and each one will come with its own standee, machine part, and cockpit card. Once you've chosen, place your standee on the start tile. Then create your player area by positioning your machine part and cockpit in front of you so that the names on each card are in the upper left corner, and they're both connected by a complete valve connection, which looks like this. Take a damage gauge and set it to 0, and a light bulb token with its on side face up. Now you're all set up and ready for the race. As we've mentioned though, the game does include some optional components like event decks, secret projects, and challenge tiles. These will alter setup just a bit, and while we won't be covering them in detail with this tutorial, we will tell you more about them at the end of the video. But for now, it's time to play the game.
The goal of the game is to be the inventor furthest past the finish line at the end of the final round. And there are no set number of rounds, but each round will consist of the same 5 phases. The draft phase, vent phase, race phase, damage phase, and the upkeep phase. Most of these phases can be played simultaneously, but there are times when player order counts. In those cases, proceed around the table according to this draft direction token, starting with the player closest to it. And here's our 3rd player to tell you a little bit more about the draft phase.
At the start of this phase, each player will draw 4 cards, 1 from each deck. So you'll have a gold, silver, and copper machine part and 1 boost card. Throughout this phase, players will take turns choosing a card from their hand and using it somehow. They'll take the remaining cards and pass them to the next player as determined by the token. This is going to continue until every card has been played. So let's take a closer look at these cards. The machine parts are similar, but the different types serve different purposes. Gold parts are mainly used to generate motion. Silver parts are typically used to generate, multiply, and convert dice that you'll use to power your invention. And copper parts do a variety of things and have valve connections on every side. The boost cards will be used differently and have very unique effects and are sometimes restricted for use at very specific times during a round. After you've chosen a card, you can attach, sell, or potentially stash it. All of these can be very important, but attaching is how you're going to build your invention, so let's start there. This allows you to actually attach a machine part to your invention. We'll get into what these can do during the race phase, but for now, there are a few things to remember as you add one to your invention. First, all cards in your machine should be rotated so that their name is in the top left corner. Second, there must be a chain of complete valve connections from every machine part back to your cockpit. For example, this part could be added here because even though this valve connection isn't complete, these are, so there is a complete connection here back to the cockpit. As long as these two rules are followed, the other sides of the machine part can connect to anything, and players are free to rearrange their invention at any time and for any reason, as long as they continue to follow the rules as they do so. A player may also discard unwanted machine parts at any time, but if they do, it is not treated as a sell action. Any dice on the part are sent back to the general supply, and any cogs on the part are returned back to the player. They place the card in the discard pile, or back in the game box if it is their inventor machine part. And of course, the cockpit can never be discarded. If you don't want to attach, you might consider sell, and selling applies both to machine parts and to boost cards. To sell, choose one available option of either dice or cogs, as shown in the top right corner of the card. Then take the respective dice or cogs from the general supply, add them to your dice pool or player area, and then discard the card to the appropriate pile. For example, a player selling a silver part card would receive either two blue dice or two cogs, but selling a boost card gives the option of those two cogs or a die of any color. Dice and cogs will be explained during the race phase, but you need to know that both are important when it comes to running your invention, and selling cards to acquire them is vital. Now your last option is to stash, which can only be done with boost cards. If you are drafting a boost card to keep, place it face down underneath your damage gauge. There is no limit to the number of boost cards stashed this way, and unless otherwise specified, these can be used at any time. When played, resolve its effects immediately. These may include a variety of things, and some may remain in effect for the duration of a phase or round. Place these cards near the track as a reminder to everyone, and discard them once they are no longer applicable. For example, Acid Rain is only playable during the vent phase. When played, that player immediately receives two cogs, and at the beginning of the next upkeep phase, all inventors will lose all gold machine parts in their invention that have dice on them. And as I said earlier, this process will continue until every card has been drafted and either attached, sold, or stashed. Once that's complete, we'll move on to the vent phase.
During the first round, players will skip this phase. This will make more sense once you've started playing. But throughout the game, players will be placing dice on their inventions to activate a variety of machine parts. These will generally stay on those slots, preventing further activations until those dice are removed. During the vent phase, players who have dice occupying any slots may spend cogs to reduce the pip values of these dice. Each cog spent allows them to either reduce one die by two or two dice by one. The whole point is to get them to zero or below in order to remove them from the slot. For example, one cog could be spent to vent this six down to a four, but the die would remain since it's not at zero or below pips. And here, one cog could be spent to reduce the three to a two and the one to a zero, returning it back to the general supply. Another cog could be spent to finish venting the other die and return it as well. And remember, fusion dice may never be vented. Their power is just too much. The big takeaway here is that players may need to vent sometimes, just like all of us, in order to use machine parts that are otherwise used up. This could be crucial if they want to win the race.
That's right, it's time for the race phase where players are going to be making as much progress as possible towards that finish line. But there's going to be so much more that happens as they do. Each player rolls all of the dice in their dice pool. This can include dice from selling cards this turn, but also some generated by boost cards or other effects. And if a player has any dice stored on diagonal slots of their invention, those may be rolled as well. Then all players perform any of the following actions in any order and as many times as they wish and are able to. Spend a cog, use your light bulb, and activate machine parts. A player may want to spend a cog in order to manipulate any unplayed die in their dice pool so that it's more effective in their invention. To do so, they simply discard a cog and can either reroll one die or instead increase or decrease its value by one. Using a light bulb will activate very specific cards in your invention. Many of the inventor cards and some machine parts have the light bulb icon on them. Just flip the light bulb token to its offside, and then, one at a time, resolve each card in your invention with that icon. You may not perform other actions between resolving these and must resolve all of them. For example, the player controlling Annie Easley might use the light bulb in order to activate the effect on their cockpit and choose to either gain a red die or two cogs. Spending cogs and using your light bulb are important, but activating your machine parts is what the game is all about. This is where the engine building you've been doing with your invention really pays off, and where you'll put all of those dice to use. First, place one or more of your dice from your dice pool onto matching open slots of one of your machine parts. You'll be able to mix different types in a single activation, but each die must be placed into an appropriate slot. For example, a player with this dice pool might choose to place one blue and one red die on their oscillation overdrive. The next step is to determine how many times the card's race effects are activated by dividing the number of pips placed on the card by the number of pips indicated by this die image, ignoring the remainder. This card's effect is a movement icon, so this placement would result in 3 movement on the track, 10 divided by 3. And remember, any dice on the card prior to this activation aren't included in this calculation, so only use the dice that were just placed. Some machine parts have a star instead of pips on the die image. This means that they will be activated once when a die is placed on it, regardless of its value. However, it must still be the correct type of die. Some activations produce multiple effects, in which case you can resolve all of them in any order you choose, keeping in mind that you cannot resolve any other effects between them. If you have the choice of effects separated by a slash, choose only one of the options. And new with this game are overcharge effects, which are optional effects in brackets that you can trigger by discarding the machine part immediately after resolving its standard effect. And all of these race effects are well detailed on the back of the rulebook and on the player reference card. But I will highlight a few here so you can better understand how these cards might activate. Some effects let you gain dice to your dice pool, and some let you discard dice off of your invention. You might take one damage, inflict one damage, or even repair one damage. You can gain a cog from the general supply, and of course, gain motion to move forward on the track. And you'll never win the race without moving forward on the track. Regular motion will get the job done. Smooth motion will help you avoid rougher terrain. Any track spaces with this icon will typically cause damage to your invention. When a player moves forward into or through this space, for example, they must reduce their damage gauge by 3. But if they used smooth movement to enter that space, the terrain damage can be ignored. And there are some other track features to be aware of too. On Machu Picchu, you'll find traps. When a player moves forward into or through one of these spaces, they must either take the indicated damage or discard an unplayed die from their dice pool. And Mars has some unique features too, canals and fusion factories. Moving forward into a canal space is a little more difficult. It requires either 2 motion or 1 smooth motion, but there can also be a benefit. If you end the race phase in a canal, you may immediately discard a die from any slot on your invention, but not a fusion die. And speaking of fusion die, if in any phase you're in a fusion factory space, you may gain as many fusion die as you like for 2 cogs each, immediately roll them, and add them to your dice pool. So there are all sorts of things to look out for when you're racing on these tracks. Some might benefit you, but at one point or another, you're bound to take some damage.
The damage phase is either a good news or bad news scenario. If your damage gauge is at zero or higher, well, that's the good news. You don't have to do anything. If your damage gauge displays a negative number, however, well, that's the bad news. You must discard that number of machine parts from your invention. But then you do get to reset the gauge back to zero. If at any time during the game you're required to discard a machine part and you don't have any machine parts left, then your invention explodes. This is not a good thing. If your invention explodes, you'll keep your cockpit in your play area along with any stashed boost cards and any cogs in your personal supply. Reset your damage gauge back to zero and move your inventor standee to the space behind the player in last place. Now, taking damage and discarding machine parts is no joke, so you'll have to manage this wisely. The next round or two might go a little bit better for you, but before we can get to them, we'll have to go through the upkeep phase.
The upkeep phase is simple. It's effectively when players reset to start a new round. First, each player should check to see if they have any diagonal slots anywhere on their invention. They may store an unplayed die on each one to use in a future round. Next, everyone should flip their lightbulb token to its on side. Then, say goodbye to all the unplayed dice in your dice pool, because they're going back to the general supply. Finally, flip the draft token to its other side so the next round's draft goes in the opposite order. And then the new round begins, unless, of course, the race is completely finished.
Yeah, but completely finishing the race is not as simple as just crossing the finish line. In fact, you can cross the finish line first. This doesn't automatically make you the winner. But when the first inventor crosses the finish line, you will complete the current round and then play one more final round. After that, the inventor who is farthest along the track is the winner. In the event of a tie, the tied player with the most machine parts is the winner. And if there's still a tie, the rules say to time travel back to the beginning of the game and keep changing history until a winner can be determined. So good luck with that.
Now, time travel is definitely not included, but there are a few options included with the game that will really ramp it up quite a bit. The event decks, for example, there's one for each track. They introduce unique effects that will be tied to or triggered by certain spaces on the track. They also serve to replace the direction token, providing a more unpredictable flow to the game round to round. Secret projects are long-term goals that players keep hidden from each other and make progress on throughout the game. At any time, unless otherwise specified, a player can reveal it to activate an effect based on the progress that they've made. Once during each race phase, players may place a run of dice of any size and regardless of color, and advance their project by the number of dice used. Once revealed, the effect is resolved corresponding to the highest level of advancement. And finally, there are new challenge tiles in the form of crowds. These are tiles that can be added to the track, and when a player moves forward into or through one, they gain 5 cogs minus 1 for each incomplete valve connection in their invention. And depending on which of these many options you might choose to add to your game, you can find more detailed setup instructions in the rulebook. Steampunk Rally Fusion is a game of drafting, engine building, and racing through dangerous tracks trying to keep your invention together at every turn. Hopefully, we've given you all the information you need to get started with the game and an idea of all the options there are to explore. Until next time, draft well, move fast, and try not to explode.